Grace, mercy, and peace be multiplied unto each of you from the God and Father of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. How excellent is the name of our Lord and God. He is worthy to be praised. And listen, this is Pentecost Sunday, amen. We are deliciously proud, amen, to have you worshiping with us today on this Pentecost Sunday. We welcome you one, we welcome you all, we welcome you twice, we welcome you three times. In the name of Jesus Christ. Listen, we have the Rainer family who's going to, amen, lead us in worship this morning. And so right where you are, amen, we want you to worship the Lord in spirit and truth as we ask the Spirit to fall fresh on us. Oh, yes, Lord, we're gathered here today.
We're all gathered
in your presence, God. Arms are open wide today, God. Come, Holy Spirit. Hands are lifted. Hearts are open, God. We welcome you.
Oh, seeking your face, asking that your Holy Spirit fall fresh on us now, God. Father, we pray today, God, that you open the eyes of our understanding. Oh, God, that we may behold the wonderful truths of Scripture. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us. Melt us and mold us and use us and fill us. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh in this place today. Father God, we just thank you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Listen, friends, I am so excited today, and we welcome you. This is Pentecost Sunday, and we are excited what God is doing in the life of Turkey Creek Church. He has added daily to the church, and we are so excited for our newest member who is united with the Turkey Creek Church this week, Dr. Susan Thornton. And so, Dr. Thornton, we welcome you, and we welcome each of you today to this, our Pentecost Sunday service. And listen, I'm eager to get to the Word, so if you'll grab your copy of God's Holy Word and meet me there, Acts chapter number 1, and I want to look at verses 1 through 8. Most call it the Acts of the Apostles, but it's really the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 8, and I will be in the English Standard Version of the Bible. That is the version that we use here at the Turkey Creek Church. To God be the glory, as Father, Son, and as Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 8, we find these words recorded. In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering with many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. Amen. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. Listen, friends, I want to shine our sermonic spotlight on verse number 8. Will you take my friend, take my hand, be my friend, and walk around the text with me? But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Listen, beloved, on this Pentecost Sunday, amen, I want to talk from this theological thought, amen, and this homiletical headline, amen. We are called to be expert witnesses for Jesus. Called to be expert witnesses for Jesus. Yes, we are. As Christians, we are called to be expert witnesses for Jesus. And as we continue this sermonic series, Expert Witnesses for Jesus Christ, I want to argue these three points today. We have been given, amen, the absoluteness of God's authority. The second point I want to argue, amen, is that we have the assurance of the Holy Spirit's power. And the third point that I want to argue today, beloved, is that we have the authorization to be witnesses, do we not? Child of God,
Here in our text of study, the final command the Lord Jesus Christ gave the disciples before he ascended into heaven, amen, was that they should, amen, declare the kingdom of God to all nations. The sad commentary in 2020 is that today's Christians are almost silent in terms of declaring God's praises, are they not? You see, during this pandemic time, many feel that they have to be within the walls of the church in order to vigorously praise our God. Not only that, but most Christians refrain from proclaiming the gospel to the world outside of the walls of the church. You see, child of God, I double dog dare you to reflect on the words that you said on yesterday and see how many of those words were declaring the life, the death, the burial. See how many of those words were declaring the resurrection and ascension and imminent return of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus is saying to you and he's saying to me in the text today, your mission until our return is to preach and teach the gospel to all nations. Amen. The Holy Spirit will come upon you shortly and empower you to carry out this task. So wait in Jerusalem until you receive, amen, this power. Isn't the Lord all right today? You see, the coming of the Spirit, amen, as described in verse number 4, amen, it is the promise of the Father. The coming of the Spirit, also described in verse number 4, amen, is described as that which the apostles heard from Jesus. And if you look over in verse number 5, you'll see, amen, this coming of the Spirit is described as that which John foretold. You see, The apostles in the text sought, amen, greater knowledge, amen. And Jesus informed them in our text of study today, amen, that they had or would have all the knowledge that they needed, amen. But how many out there know today that what they needed was power, amen? They needed power to proclaim the gospel so that men would believe and be saved. You see, Pentecost was the occasion in which God chose to bestow power on his apostles, did he not? Consider point number 1 with me, if you will. Let us consider the absoluteness of God's authority. Walk around verses 6 and 7 with me. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know times or season that the Father has fixed by his own authority. Beloved, when the apostles pressed Jesus here in the text in verse number 6 to tell them the time when the kingdom of God will be established, notice verse number 7, Jesus graciously refuses, amen, by informing them that this information, amen, is outside of their authority. He says to them to stay in your lane. He says it's not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his authority. Does your Bible read like mine? In other words, there is no need to know as far as the apostles are concerned. Child of God, this information, this timing is something that falls entirely in the purview, amen, and within the boundaries of the Father's authority. In other words, what I'm trying to wrap tight, make it light, and put a hammer so you can tote it with you today, God has absolute authority, does he not? Child of God, for the apostles to seek this knowledge, amen, is to clearly go outside of their scope of authority. So here in verse 7, Jesus calls the apostles to not focus on the future, but focus on the present. And I believe, friends, today, amen, that's what God is calling you and I to focus on now, to witness for him. He wants us to witness in this present age, to serve this present age through witnessing our calling to fulfill. So instead of discussing their future kingdom in verse number 7, Jesus draws their attention. He tugs their attention and changes their attention to their present responsibility in verse number 8. And this is your responsibility and my responsibility. He says to them in the text, he says to us, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea, amen, and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. Isn't the Lord all right today? Child of God, will you permit me to compare and contrast verses 7 and 8? Notice verse number 7. It speaks of the future. And verse number 8 speaks of the present. Verse number 7 talks about what they will not receive. And verse number 8 talks about what they receive now. Somebody say Holy Spirit power. Verse number 7 talks about the promised messianic kingdom. Amen. And verse number 8 deals with the promised Holy Spirit. Verse number 7 talks about a restoration of a nation. And verse number 8, hallelujah, talks about salvation of souls. Verse number 7 talks about the rebirth of Israel. Amen. And verse number 8 talks about the birth of the church. Verse number 7 deals with a prophecy of a kingdom. And verse number 8, hallelujah, deals with prophecy of power, Holy Spirit power. Amen. Verse number 7 deals with timing that is not known by them. Amen. And verse number 8 deals with timing to be known by them. Amen. Verse number 7 deals with timing that is fixed by the Father. And verse number 8 deals with timing that's not many days from now. Child of God, Jesus is letting the people in the text know. He is letting you know him, man. He is letting me know. He is letting us know that you and I cannot, amen, know the future, but you and I can make the future. Let me press rewind right there. You might not be able to know the future, but child of God, you certainly can make the future. So Jesus says to us, get up, amen, and get ready to go and make the future. But you will receive power in verse number 8 when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. Child of God, you can make the future. Can I tell you why? Which leads me into point number 2. Because you have the assurance of the Holy Spirit's power. Yes, point number 2. You have the fact that you have the assurance of the Holy Spirit's power. Notice here in verse number 8. Jesus alludes to his previous mention of baptism, amen, of the Holy Spirit. And now he associates this baptism with the receipt of supernatural power, which was necessary so that the disciples could be witnesses for Christ. Repeat after me, child of God. God has given me the ability to be a witness for him. How do I know I'm glad you asked? Walk with me in verse number 8. Notice what Jesus said. You will receive. Child of God, this tells us that the power was something future, was it not? And this, amen, prophetic promise that is found in Acts, the first chapter and the fourth verse, amen, in Luke 24 and 49 was fulfilled, amen, on Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. So, child of God, this power is not so much a gift from the Holy Spirit, but this power, amen, is intimately associated with the presence of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer. Can I ask you a question? What was the great need of the church in the text? The answer is power from the Holy Spirit. Can I ask you another question? What is the greatest need of the church today? The answer is power from the Holy Spirit. Beloved, during this time of pandemic, some of the PPE, amen, the personal, amen, protective equipment that I wear, amen, while doing ministry and essential errands, amen, and working, is a glove. I wear gloves, y'all. Amen. So can I teach a little bit about power? You see, you and I, friends, are very similar to a glove. We're so similar to this glove, it's not even funny, amen. Because it is the Holy Spirit on the inside of you and I that gives us the ability to be a witness for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In other words, the filling of the Holy Spirit, amen, is like a hand filling a glove. You see, if I was to take this glove and I told this glove, glove, get me, amen, a drink of water. Get me a drink of water. This glove, amen, didn't have no ability. Amen. I would probably be waiting right here from now on because the glove itself does not have ability or power to accomplish giving me a drink of water on its own. Oh, shucks in here. Amen. But if I put my hand, Lord have mercy, help your boy, amen, teach for a little while, Lord Jesus. If I put my hand inside the glove, whatever my hand does, amen, isn't the Lord all right? Whatever my hand does, the glove has the ability and power to do, amen, whatever is on the inside that is controlling that glove. As you see, the glove won't work as good. It won't work that good, amen, if it's not filled. And some of us only want the Holy Spirit to get us in a little bit, amen, and we're not going to have much power. Beloved, when you get saved, the Holy Spirit is in you, but you got to allow the Holy Spirit to fill you, to walk with you, to talk with you, to give you power to do ministry, to give you power to live right, to give you power to give right. Trucker Creek and Guest. When the Spirit fills our lives, it gives us enabling power. Without the enabling of the Holy Spirit, our lives can't be much and do much. But when we allow the Spirit to fill us, Lord have mercy, Jesus, we are enabled to do whatever the Spirit wants us to do. Beloved, the Holy Spirit works in different ways in the life of the believer. Amen. The Holy Spirit is alongside us to comfort us, to convict us, and to encourage us. Is the Holy Spirit not? The Holy Spirit, He is in us. We become the temple of the Holy Spirit. He dwells in us, and we receive Jesus as our Savior. And in this text today, the Holy Spirit comes upon us, giving us power, amen, in our lives to do things that we would be unable to do without the enabling power and the help of the Holy Spirit. Which brings me to my third and my final point. Not only do we have the absoluteness of God's authority, not only do we have the assurance of the Holy Spirit's power in the text, but finally, my brothers and sisters, amen, you and I have the authorization to be a witness. Repeat after me. I have the authorization to be a witness. Amen. Can you hear Jesus saying in verse number 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, amen, and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Child of God, a witness simply tells others what Jesus has done in your life. Oh yes, and I submit to you that it is not a witness's job, amen, to get a person saved. It's simply the witness job to give their testimony, amen, and let the Holy Spirit does his work. In other words, if a person pays attention to your testimony and respond to the work that God is doing in the midst of their heart, then they will receive salvation from God. Keep walking in verse 8 with me. The disciples were to be witness in Jerusalem, where Jesus has just been rejected and brutally, unjustly, and unfairly killed. Yes, they were also to bear witness, amen, in Samaria. Amen, the Jews hated the Samaritans, and the Samaritans hated the Jews, but they were to go into Samaria, amen, and the text said that they were to go to the remotest parts of the earth. You see, perhaps the disciples' thought process was like many of our thought processes are and were, amen, that they were able to pick and choose who they would witness to first, amen. But they soon learned that this same gospel that converts the Jews also converts the Gentiles. This same gospel that, amen, converts pastors, amen, also, amen, converts pimps and prostitutes, amen. This same gospel, amen, that converts deacons also, amen, converts devilish folks, amen. This same gospel that, amen, converts mothers of the church also, amen, converts managed folk, amen, in the Lord, all right. In other words, child of God, amen, you and I must take this gospel to people, amen, who we may not naturally like or be drawn to. Amen. Oh, America would be a better place today with all that is going on, amen, if we would just take this gospel instead of hate, amen. And when we share the gospel of Jesus Christ, Child of God, you and I must remember that it is the power of God for salvation to all who believe. Child of God, every witness, amen, every Christian is called to be a witness. The question becomes, are we effective witnesses? Amen, or are we a hindrance to the cause of Christ? You see, amen, the word witness, amen, is a major theme throughout this book of Acts. And beloved, according to verse number 8, oh yes, being a witness is the Lord's command. Amen. And since we cannot escape, amen, being a witness of some sort, amen, we must bring glory and honor to the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In our words, in our thoughts, and in our actions as we live for Jesus. Jesus says to us in the text, oh yes, you will. Yes, you will. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Amen. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. Oh yes, and in all Judea. Amen. And Samaria. Oh yes, and to the end of the earth. Yes, witness in Jerusalem, which is the capital city. Amen. The place where they were at the moment. Amen. Witness in Judea, which is the southern portion of Israel. Oh yes, it is the area that surrounds Jerusalem. Witness in Samaria, that is the area that is north of Judea, where the half-bred Samaritan people live. Oh yes, witness to the uttermost parts of the earth. That is everything that is in the known world. You see, this command to be a witness, amen, follows the outline of the books of Acts. You see, in Acts, amen, verses chapters 1 through 7, the gospel went through Jerusalem. Amen. In Acts 8 through 12, the gospel went through Judea and in Samaria. And I'm so glad that in Acts chapter 13 through 28, the Bible says that the gospel, amen, on Paul's missionary journeys, amen, it went as far as Rome. And child of God, this is a good example of how ministry grows. We need to try to quit having these canned ministries and allow the Holy Spirit power to grow ministry and to grow you and to grow me as witnesses of Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to let you know today, amen, that yes, it does. Witnessing starts at home, does it not? Amen. And the witness in our personal life, in order to be a healthy witness, amen, the witness must start at home. And all I want to let you know today, friends, is that you got to be careful about trying to jump out there and get everybody else in the world saved, and you got folks in your own house that's going to bust hell wide open. In other words, what I'm letting you know today, as I get out of here, amen, that charity, oh yes, it does, it starts at home. Amen, and then charity has a way of working itself a little further. The Bible says that charity starts at home, amen, and then it spreads abroad. How to reach the masses? I'm talking about men from every birth. For an answer, yes, he did. Jesus gave the key. And he said to you and I, friends, if I be lifted up from the earth, oh, yes, I'll draw all men unto me. Oh, the world is hungry. Yes, it's hungry for the living bread. Why don't you lift the Savior up for them to see? Trust him and do not doubt the words that he said. Yes, I'll draw all men unto me. Whatever you do, don't exalt the preacher. Amen, and don't exalt the pew. Just preach the gospel, simple, full, and free. Prove him and you will find, yes, you will, that his promise is true. Yes, that I'll draw all men unto me. Lift them up by living as a Christian ought. Let the world in you the Savior see. Yes, then men were glad that once follow him who said, I'll draw all men unto me. Yes, do you know the Lord Jesus? Amen. He is the best man that ever lived on this earth. Yes, he has no degree, yet they call him teacher. Amen. He has no, amen, degree, yet they call him healer. You know him, don't you? Amen. He had no armies what he was running around with while he was walking through Jerusalem. Amen. And yet kings and kingdoms feared him. He's in the Lord all right today. Amen. While he was walking in Jerusalem, he had no armies, yet he conquered this whole wide world. Y'all know him, don't you? He committed no crime. Amen. And they hung him on a tree on a hill called Calvary. Yes, they gave him a criminal's death. I got to ask you a question. Isn't the Lord all right today? Do you know Jesus? And have you tried Jesus? Y'all know him, don't you? Ministered in Jerusalem. Amen. Isn't the Lord all right? Born in Bethlehem. Reared in Nazareth. Crucified on Calvary. Y'all know him, don't you? A way out of no way. A very present help in the time of trouble. Our refuge, our strength. Our light and our salvation. Y'all know him, don't you? Has he made a way in your life? Has God done anything for you? He opened the blind eyes. He unstopped deaf ears. Amen. He made a way out of no way. Y'all know him, don't you? Mary's baby. The lily of the valley. The bright and morning star. The great I am. Y'all know him, don't you? Amen. He is all right today. He woke you up this morning. He started you all the way. You ought to give a witness to the Lord. How good is the Lord? I was sinking deep in sin. I was far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within. I was sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea, oh, shucks in here. He heard my despairing cry. And from sinful waters he lifted me. And now safe am I. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. It was love that lifted me. When nothing else could help. Mama prayers couldn't help. Mother dear prayer couldn't help. Daddy prayer couldn't help. It was love that lifted me. I'm a witness of the resurrection of power and the Holy Ghost power of Jesus Christ. I wasn't fit to live. And Lord, no, I didn't need to die. But he picked me up. He turned me around. He placed my feet on solid ground. Beloved, will you tarry? Will you tarry as you shelter in place? Our lives without the filling of the Holy Spirit is like this glove. Beloved, this glove can't do much. I know we call it personal protective equipment, but this glove can't do much unless it's filled with enabling power. Maybe you never asked Jesus inside of you, into your life, so you can have that enabling power of the Holy Spirit. That power, you see, our life is like a glove. We can't do much unless we allow God to fill us. And we don't need to just give him a little bit. We need to allow him to have complete control. It wouldn't do no good for just this thumb to be filled. When the whole hand is filled, as the Spirit moves, the power will flow through your life. Listen, maybe you've been feeling powerless. The question is, quit praying for more of the Holy Spirit and allow the Holy Spirit to get more of you. Will you allow the Spirit to take complete control? Listen, friends, God wants to fill you. He wants to bless you. He wants to fill you so that he can use you for his glory. If you're here today and you have never accepted him as your Lord and Savior, hallelujah, today is your day. Listen, friends, this is your time to be filled with the Spirit. Will you bow with me in prayer if you have never accepted him? Will you pray this prayer with me and repeat after me? And when you pray this prayer, you will be saved and you will be no more unsaved than water can fall out of well. If you want the filling of the Spirit of power, will you pray with me? Lord God, I come into your life now, Lord. Lord God, I'm a sinner, God. And God, I need your blessing. I need your saving, God.
Oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will save my soul, that you will forgive my sins. God, that you will cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Thank you, God, for saving my soul. I confess that I've sinned against you in thought. I confess that I've sinned against you in words. I confess that I've sinned against you in deeds. By what I've done, by what I've left undone, I've not loved you with my whole heart. I'm truly sorry, and I humbly repent in the name of Jesus. God, I confess that Jesus is the Son of God, crucified, died, and buried, and he rose with all power on the third day. Thank you for saving my soul. I'm saved. I'm truly saved in the name of Jesus and through his blood. Amen. Beloved, if you prayed that prayer, you are saved. Hallelujah. You have new life. You have been born again in the spirit. And he who the Son set free is free indeed. Listen, don't allow others to tell you that you haven't been saved, because if you truly believe in your heart, you are saved. So hallelujah. And you're saved to be a witness. You're saved. You're not going to do everything just right. It doesn't matter how long you do this journey. You're not going to do everything just right. When you find yourself not doing right, re-return, pent back to the top, back to God, and confess your sins. He is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins, friends, and cleanse you from all unright. Listen, if you made that decision today, we need you to log on www.turkeycreekbaptistchurch.org. Please let us know your decision to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior today. We would love to be your church home. I would love to be your pastor. Amen. But if you are in a situation where you want to be a member of another church, listen, friends, we will gladly send you to that church, because we are the body of Christ. Amen. But again, I would love to be your pastor. Maybe you're here today and you've been hurting and you need that filling of the Holy Spirit. You're like a glove without being filled. You're powerless. You're weak. You're fragile. You've been trying it on your own, but you had no enabling power. Listen, will you go to God with me? You've been hurting. You've been trying to figure it out. You've been frustrated. You've been trying to do it on your own. Doubt, devastation, defeat, fear. If that's you today, can't get along in relationships, no power to correct it. Can't get along on your job, sometimes even the church. If that's you today, will you bow with me? Lord God, I bring my problems. I bring all of my cares. I bring all of my concerns to you. You said in your words, cast your cares upon me, for I care for you. God, I need your enabling power to tear down strongholds in my life, to remove barriers, to restore relationships, oh God, to help me love others, oh God. God, we lift people up in our family who are not saved. May they know you in saving faith and saving power. Come into my life, God. Clean up my life. Fix my life. Rearrange it according to your glory. And God, fill me with your spirit that I may be empowered and emboldened to do your will. God, this is my prayer. Through the blood and in the name that is above every name. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. And every heart said amen. Listen, friends, we're glad that you worship with us today, and we are here for you to pray with you. If you want to let us know your decision or follow up with prayer, log on to www.turkeycreekbaptistchurch.org. Click on the contact us link and let us know how we can be of service to you. Listen, we love you. We're here to serve you. We're here to be a witness for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. and you might want to unite with this church, listen, I would love to be a pastor. Contact us and let us know your decision. Again, listen, we are so excited at the Turkey Creek Church that God has added to the church. And again, we thank God for our newest member of the Turkey Creek Missionary Baptist Church, Dr. Susan Thornton. We love you. God bless you. We're so excited for you to be, amen, in this part of Zion. Amen. And you might be out there today. Again, just log on to www.turkeycreekbaptistchurch.org. And we would love, amen, to talk with you and to help you, amen, be all that you can be for God, friends. So don't forget, www.turkeycreekbaptistchurch.org. Amen. At this time, we are going to hear from Devonna for our announcements. Next week is Education Sunday. We have Coach Nick Collins, the defense coordinator for the Dublin Fighting Irish, who is going to bring us a message for our graduates and young people. So we're looking forward, our hearts to burn and hear from the heart of Coach Nick Collins on next week. Again, friends, we love you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. The Lord be gracious unto you and lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Again, let us receive our announcements. And after our announcements, go be a witness and to love and serve the Lord.
Greetings from the news desk here at Turkey Creek Missionary Baptist Church, where Dr. Frederick C. Williams is our pastor. My name is Devonna Watson, and I'm here to bring you this week's news from the Creek. Monday prayer line will be at 7 a.m. and 9 p.m. The toll-free number is 1-302-202-1110. The conference code is 777-581. And now, let's take a look at this week's prayer request.
This week's prayer request, we have Annie L. Lowry, Osnola Davis, Mother Christine Baker, Hattie Thomas, Marie Smith, Martha Farmer, Bobby Edmond, Lucille Collins, Bobby Collins, Marquita Graves, Latrell Roach, the Drayton Baker family, Joyce Tyson Williams, all P-12 and college students, Shirley Baker, Vaughn London, Pat Rooks, Victoria Wright, Rosa Lee Simmons, Deacon Henry Lane, McKinley Williams, Deacon Coleman Smith, Martha Ross, Wilbert Roberts, Ella Lee Way, Mary Edmond, and Drew Watson.
And now for this week's birthdays.
Today, we have two very special birthdays. Takaya Roja, May 31st, and Taylor Roja, May 31st. This week's birthdays, we have Nathaniel Smith, June 1st, Demora Bethay, June 1st, Annie H. Bell, June 2nd, Alexis Baker, June 2nd, Drew Watson, June 2nd, Deacon Richard Hunter, June 3rd, Christine Lowry, June 3rd, and Rodney Butts, June 3rd.
Thank you, Turkey Creek and friends, for your generosity and stewardship of the resources God has blessed you with. Please send your tithes and offerings to 1164 Williewood Road, East Dublin, Georgia, 31027, to the attention of Catherine Smith. Or you may use our Cash App to give your tithes and offerings. Our cash tag is the $TCMBC828. That's $TCMBC828.
Be sure to save the date starting every Tuesday, May 5th through June 16th. Join First Lady Melissa Williams at 7 p.m. on the Zoom line for Women's Bible Study, Discerning the Voice of God by Priscilla Shirer. You may sign up by sending an email to turkeycreekb@gmail.com. Be sure to tell us how you want to receive your materials via email or standard mail when you sign up. Here's a spiritual challenge for you. Will you commit to praying for the salvation of one lost person and seek opportunities to share the gospel with him or her? It can be a friend, relative, coworker, classmate, or acquaintance. It can even be an enemy. After all,
Jesus did tell us to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us in Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. Pray and invest in one person the Lord places on your heart that needs Christ. Make a commitment today. Identify your one. Begin praying daily for your one and seeking opportunities to tell them about Jesus and invite them to church. A transformation through our witness tip of the week is, seek you, the Lord, while he may be found. Call you on him while he is near. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 6.
This has been your weekly news from the Creek. My name is Devonna Watson, and I hope to see you all next Sunday. Have a blessed day.